Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about enolization.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So we know a little bit about enolates. Certainly we know how to form them. We know that we can take some ketone or aldehyde. In this case, we're going to start with this ketone, and we can use a strong base of some kind, and we're going to do an acid-base reaction. We're going to get an alpha proton, and we're going to form an enolate, right? But the thing is, sometimes we can have a ketone such that we could produce different enolates, depending on which proton is involved in the acid-base reaction. So this is an excellent opportunity to talk about thermodynamic control versus kinetic control. So let's say we have this substrate here. Let's look at what will happen if we use two different bases. So let's say we start off, let's use sodium hydroxide. So let's just write our hydroxide right there. Now, what's going to happen is hydroxide is very small. It is very sterically unhindered. Okay, so it is going to experience a similar activation energy when it approaches either side of the molecule. So notice here that we've got this methyl group here and a proton versus two protons here. So this is the more sterically hindered side of the molecule. So if a base is going to approach from this direction and grab one of these versus if it's going to approach from this direction and grab this one, remember, these are the three alpha protons that are available for enolization because all of these are alpha to the carbonyl. And so any base, regardless of what it is, there's going to be some difference in terms of the activation energy if it approaches this way or this way. But the thing is this. Hydroxide is so sterically unhindered that the difference is going to be relatively negligible. So even though it has a higher activation energy, just a little bit, it's going to be relatively negligible, and it is going to go this way. Right, it's going to go this way, and we're going to get the thermodynamic enolate. And the reason that this is thermodynamically driven is that it is driven by the stability of the product. So notice here, remember when we talked about alkene stability, we know that the more substituted an alkene is, the more stable it is. And this is the most substituted enolate that we can have because the double bond is here where this methyl group is. So here is our enolate, and this is our thermodynamic enolate because the product sits lower on an energy diagram. So we're here, we took the red pathway right here. These red arrows represent the red pathway because we have a slightly higher activation energy, but the key thing is that we're ending up lower on the energy diagram. This is the more thermodynamically favorable product. Okay, so now looking at the other side, this is an opportunity to introduce a very big bulky base that is great for enolization when we want to go the other direction. That's LDA, lithium diisopropyl amide. So here is our lithium counter ion, and here are our two isopropyl groups. So that's what LDA looks like. And we can see here that it's very sterically hindered, right? We've got these two isopropyl groups. And so the reason that that is relevant is that whereas hydroxide was very, very sterically unhindered, which means that the discrepancy in activation energy associated with hydroxide approaching this side or this side was pretty much negligible. I mean, it still is a little higher to come from that side, but that was offset by the thermodynamic favorability of the product. So the stability of the product was what drove that reaction. And so the activation energies were not that different. But LDA is so bulky that now all of a sudden the activation energy associated with approaching this side of the molecule, where it's more sterically hindered, is dramatic. It is actually a much bigger discrepancy because of how hindered this is. So LDA is going to preferentially approach this portion of the molecule. So we're going to go over here. I'll draw it from LDA. That's fine. And we're going to go over here. And now these blue arrows represent the pathway to get the kinetic enolate. And so the key here is that we can see that the kinetic enolate is higher on the energy diagram. It's not as stable as the thermodynamic enolate because here we see that the carbons participating in this pi bond are attached to three other alkyl groups. It's essentially a tri-substituted alkene in the form of an enolate, Over here, we only have disubstituted, right? These two carbons participating in the pi bond are attached to only two other alkyl groups. So objectively, this is a less stable structure. That's why it sits higher on the energy diagram. But the thing is that the activation energy is going to be much lower than the thermodynamic pathway, because the activation energy, right, we're looking at a situation where the base is approaching the less hindered side here, okay? So that's the key that we want to understand, basically in terms of thermodynamic control and kinetic control. Thermodynamic control, whether we are talking about enolization or any other situation, when we're comparing thermodynamic versus kinetic control, the thermodynamic control is always associated with the pathway that results in the lowest energy product. So that's the key. Thermodynamic pathway, we're looking at the lowest energy product. However, kinetic control, we're talking about the lowest activation energy. That is the feature of kinetic control. So it's not that LDA is only going to come this side. It's also going to approach from that side. But the activation energy is so much higher that so many more times when a collision occurs in this direction, it will be with insufficient kinetic energy so as to get the acid-base reaction to go. So LDA will just ping off the side, right? It'll just come here and it'll bounce right off. Whereas over here, because the activation energy is so much lower, it is much, much more likely that a collision will be of sufficient activation energy to get over, of sufficient kinetic energy to get over this smaller activation barrier. So this applies to enolization. This also applies to E2 elimination, right? When we're looking at hydroxide versus tert butoxide, say. This is exactly the same principle, and this also explains why we get Zaitsev versus Hoffman elimination products. So this can apply to a lot of different situations. It also applies to enolization, as we are seeing here. So the two main takeaways are, number one, if we have some substrate where we have an opportunity to get two different enolates, two structurally different enolates, the way that we will preferentially get one over the other is if we use a sterically unhindered base, we will get the more substituted possible enolate. And if we use a very sterically hindered base, we will necessarily get the less substituted of the possible enolates. And then to tie that into the other main takeaway, when we are looking at thermodynamic versus kinetic control, once again, thermodynamic control is going to bring us to the lowest possible, the lowest energy product, and we can do that by heating things up, right? If we heat things up enough, we're going to be able to get over any activation barrier that will be that won't be stopping us, and we're going to go to the lowest energy product. Whereas slightly cooler temperatures typically are going to favor a kinetic situation, and once again, any kinetic product is going to be dictated by what has the lowest activation energy. Because if the temperature is very low, then things are all whatever's in solution is only going to be able to get over a lower activation energy and not a higher one. So that's what we need to know about regioselective enolization and thermodynamic versus kinetic control. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.